Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 28th April, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 10. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Korea's aim for denuclearization. So we have been discussing North Korea and South Korea going to have their summit, and this is the summit which took place in which the leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un, met the president of South Korea, Moon Jae-in. So this is the first inter-Korea summit in more than a decade, and here this meet has pledged complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. So they met at the border between the two nations, that is, which is the heavily fortified demilitarized zone. So here they had a handshake, and this, the place where they met, this is the truce village as such, which has been Panmunjom. So here is where they met, and they had this Panmunjom declaration also agreed upon, in which they have promised to pursue phased arms reduction, cease hostile acts, transform their fortified border into a peace zone, and seek multilateral talks with other countries, including USA. So this has been agreed upon. Even the North Korean leader invited President of South Korea to a visit to North Korean capital Pyongyang next year, and this has also been accepted. This is the present scenario. Even we have already discussed that it is expected that North Korean leader Kim Jong-un would also meet US President Donald Trump, which will be historical because it would be the first time that sitting leaders of both the countries would meet. So Korean leaders and US presidents, former US presidents, have met. Means they have met after they have completed their term as president, but not after or before, but not while they were president. So this will be the first time that two sitting leaders of the two countries would meet if this meet takes place. So this is there. Also, this one statement which you should know is that the two Koreas announced they would work with US and China this year to declare an official end to the 1950s Korean War. So we have seen that the Korean War was not formally ended, and now they are going to formally end this 1950s Korean War, which was part of the Cold War. So US and China, Russia were supporting each of the Korean Koreas. South Korea was supported by US and the communists supported North Korea. So they are seeking an agreement on permanent and solid peace. So here you can see the details are shown. This is the demarcation zone between North Korea and South Korea. The next is, we are engines of global growth, Z. So Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Chinese President Xi Jinping recently met for open-ended talks, an informal summit which took place presently. And here they have agreed that this summit is for normalization of ties and will not be guided by any rigid talking points. And it is expected to align India and China to counter the headwinds of growing protectionism and other aspects. So it was an informal summit. There was no talking points finally finalized as such for the meet. It was a free-flowing discussion which took place. So it was an informal summit here in Wuhan in China. So this has taken place. So there's a need for full normalization of ties too, which had been affected by the 1962 India-China war. So of course, resolution of boundary dispute is a major issue which needs to be resolved and has been going on for decades now. But there are other aspects on which India and China need to come together, and that has taken the lead presently. The growing protectionism, what we see with respect to US also, the protectionism in the which US is imposing tariffs on its imports of steel and aluminium. So India and China both are affected. So here China and India, especially China, wants to come together with India to counter these aspects. The next is, Supreme Court stays trial in Kathua rape case. So this is regarding the Kathua rape case. The Supreme Court has stayed the trial in this case and has given time to the accused persons to respond to a petition filed by the victim's father seeking transfer of the trial to Chandigarh. So here, earlier we had seen, the CJI had said that the case regarding the lawyers in Jammu and Kashmir interfering in the adjudication of justice, that aspect should not be taken to the forefront because it would affect the main issue of the trial of this gang rape and murder. So now the CJI has said, this is three judge bench led by CJI, he has agreed to hear the submission for and against handing over the case to CBI. So this will also be looked into, and the CJI has clarified that when a case is sought to be transferred, then the accused persons also have a say. So here the accused persons have been asked to file their file their response as such. Then next is years spent waiting for RTI replies, petitioner's claim. So this is regarding right to information. The Right to Information Act of 2005 has given the citizens of India the right to ask for information from public officials. So there is the Central Information Commission, which has been established at the central level, which looks into appeals with respect to RTI cases, which come from the information commissions, which are there across states. So state information commissions have also been established across states under the act. And also in every office, as such governmental office, there is a public information officer, PIO. So any information which is sought has to be responded to within 30 days, and if it is life and death situation, then within 48 hours. So that's what the act mandates. But then when the information is denied or there are such such issues which arise, then the person has a right to appeal on this. So that appeal as such goes to Information Commission and State Information Commission and then to Central Information Commission. So it has been seen that these information commissions have been working with lack of transparency. Even the composition of information commissions are sometimes skewed. Sometimes they are also led by only one commissioner. Then it affects their functioning because there are huge amount of delays in responses. Also, inadequate imposition of penalties are seen to be imposed by them. So all these concerns have been raised in this study which has been undertaken. And in this, it has been said this is a group called Satark Nagrik Sangathan, Center for Equity Studies and as such. So these advocacy groups have conducted a study and these issues have been highlighted. So they say that in Kerala, an activist from Kerala says, RTI activist says that State Information Commission in Kerala is functioning with only one commissioner, and even though there are nearly 14,000 appeals and complaints pending as such, still there is only one commissioner. And that since there are so many appeals pending, such a huge backlog, then it is impossible to get a date before at least a year. So means your application will come before the State Information Commission after so long. So of course it says that this can be seen as a tactic of the government to dissuade people from filing RTIs. So this condition has been highlighted. Even an RTI activist from Andhra Pradesh says that AP has not had a functional State Information Commission for the past 11 months. So such concerns, issues have been highlighted regarding functioning of the RTI Act. So here you can see the rate of disposal of RTI cases is shown. Rate of disposal is good of 80-90%. The number of applications have been increasing. So carryovers take place and unresolved applications have increased a lot. So here you can see how from 2012 to present, the cases have increased. Then next is death penalty proposed for rape of boys under 12 too. So we had recently seen that ordinance was promulgated by the government in which it said that life up to death or death sentence would be awarded to people who are guilty of raping a girl under 12 years of age. So now the government has said that it will also amend the POSCO Act. So an amendment, formal amendment, not an ordinance now, but they have proposed an amendment to the POSCO Act itself, which will provide death sentence for rape of boys under 12 too. So this would be incorporated into the Act too, because otherwise it is a discrepancy which has come through. So this POSCO Act is making death sentence gender neutral. So POSCO is protection of children from sexual offences. So activists on the other hand have also opposed death penalty for child sexual abuse on the ground that it is not a deterrent. Even death sentence as such is not going to deter rapes, because of course there is punishment for rape. What is required is improving the conviction rate in rape cases. The person guilty should be convicted. If the person guilty is left scot-free and conviction rates go low, you have to find the culprit and convict him. So that's what the activists are demanding in rape cases. Then next is CISF to guard UIDAI data center in Gurugram. So UIDAI, Unique Identification Authority of India's data center, which is located in Manesar in Gurugram, will now be provided security by CISF, Central Industrial Security Force. So 159 CISF personnel will protect it from possible terror strikes and other threats. So it is UIDI has been set up to develop and implement Aadhaar scheme, as we already know. So it provides necessary institutional, technical and legal infrastructure for Aadhaar. And you should know about CISF too. under security forces, which is also part of the syllabus. So CISF, it was set up under the Act of Parliament in 1969. It was, so it's for industrial security, and it was subsequently made into an armed force by another Act of Parliament passed in 1983. So it is under the Union Ministry of Home Affairs, headquarters is in New Delhi. It provides security cover to over 300 industrial establishments in the country. There are government infrastructure projects located all across India, facilities like, you know, even airports, hydroelectric thermal power stations, steel plants, fertilizer units, refineries, major ports, etc. Even space installations, plants, space installation sites, atomic power plants as such are all given security by the CISF. This is there. Also, currency note presses as such are protected by CISF, central PSUs, etc. It also provides consultancy services to private industries also and organizations of the government. So this is the role it plays. It also plays a major role in disaster management. Then next is collegium allotting cases will cause chaos. So this is the Attorney General of India, K.K. Venugopal, who is giving his viewpoint, because former Law Minister Shanti Bhushan has filed a petition in the Supreme Court demanding that the collegium of Supreme Court judges collectively should allocate cases. Because we have seen that CJI has declared that he is the master of the roster and he alone will decide on such cases. But then there have been petitions filed that that should not be the case. And this petition calls for collegium of Supreme Court judges to collectively be functioning as master of the roster or be deciding on allocation of cases in the Supreme Court. On this, Attorney General representing the government has responded that collegium allotting cases would invite chaos because it would mean judges deciding for themselves which case they should hear. So collegium makes appointments, decides on appointments to the judiciary. So collegium means group of judges coming together, the senior judges coming together. So if the senior judges come together and decide on allocation of cases, then there will be a clear viewpoint or clear, you know, majority seen or clear way in which decisions can be taken on which case should be heard by which bench. That is what allocation of cases is all about. But presently what is happening is CJI himself is individually allotting cases. That has been going on for long, but presently this issue has been raised. That the way cases have been allotted to junior Supreme Court judges as such too has been a point put forth by next four senior judges who went before the press also. So this is the case, but in which the Attorney General says that this should not happen. The collegium should not hear cases. The court has said the plea should be tested on the touchstone of Article 145 of the Constitution, that is rules of court governing its practices and procedures. So what the Constitution intends or what the Constitution says is on the basis of which this issue should be resolved is the viewpoint taken by the Supreme Court. Already in two separate judgments, you should know Supreme Court has declared that he alone is the master of the roster. So this, he says he is an institution in himself. So these two judgments of November 2017 and April 2018 have already been, verdicts given, but now still this petition is being heard on. So this is the Attorney General's viewpoint given. Then next is primacy of collegium violated. So we saw that two judges' names were given to the government for approval to be appointed as judges of Supreme Court. That was the senior advocate Indu Malhotra and Chief Justice of Uttarakhand High Court, K.M. Joseph. So on this, we saw these were the names given in Jan, together given in Jan by the Supreme Court Collegium for appointment as judges in the Supreme Court. And we saw that the government presently, 2 days back we saw, government approved the appointment of Indu Malhotra as Supreme Court judge and she has been administered oath, but Justice K.M. Joseph's elevation has been stopped. So the government has sent this back for reconsideration of the collegium, but now former CJI, Justice R.M. Lodha, he says that his segregation of names by the government, that one name has been approved and one name has been sent back for reconsideration, this is challenging the primacy of Supreme Court collegium. When names are jointly recommended, then the government cannot unilaterally segregate names. So this is, he says that incidents took place even in 2014 when he was the CJI, when the names were given together. The government failed the elevation of senior advocate Gopal Subramaniam to the Supreme Court. So on this, Justice R.M. Lodha had written a scathing letter to the government that this cannot be done unilaterally. It has to inform, first inform the CJI. So in this case too, this is what he says should have been done. The CGI should have been informed. He says why the segregation of names should not take place. The reasoning he gives is that when the names of judges are sent by the collegium to the government, then there are many factors which they keep into consideration, like who should become the CGI, because CGI is by seniority. The next senior most judge in the Supreme Court becomes the Chief Justice of India. So on the basis of seniority, when this takes place and when they are recommending names as Supreme Court judges, they also serial them that how they would become judges. So based on seniority, means if the appointed first, then the senior. So in this case now, since Indu Malhotra has been appointed, she becomes a senior judge, then Justice K.M. Joseph. So if he is appointed later. So that is the aspect which affects who becomes the CGI too. So that is why withholding a person's name and letting only one name being through is going to affect the seniority, and this is tinkering with the appointment of judges, which should not be acceptable. He says that the memorandum of procedure for appointment of judges should be modified in such a way that government should be allowed to segregate names only after consulting the CJ. Then next is, should Babri case go to statute bench? So this is regarding the Ram Janma Bhoomi Babri Masjid title dispute. That is the dispute regarding the property. So this dispute has been argued in the Supreme Court that it should be shifted to a 5-judge constitutional bench. So senior advocate representing Mr. M. Siddiq, he argues that this is a unique case. This dispute is sui generis. Two major religious communities of the country are involved here, and it would affect the social fabric of the country. So that is why he says that this case should be referred to a 5-judge constitutional bench. While senior advocate Harish Salve representing the other side, they say that this case should not be considered as a special case because the country has already moved away from the 1992 events, the events in which the car sevaks demolished the Babri Masjid on December 6, 1992, and after that riots, Hindu-Muslim riots erupted across the country. So he claims that the country has moved away from this incident and this should not be considered as a unique case as such. So he says that this is only a property dispute and should be treated so. He says political and religious sensibilities should be left outside the gates of the Supreme Court. Then next is, GST nets rupees 7.19 lakh crore revenue in financial year 2018. So this is regarding the GST, which has been put into effect last year, and now the amount collected between August 2017 to March 2018 is said to be 7.19 lakh crores. So this is central GST, state GST, integrated GST collected, means the interstate GST as such too, and cess. So all these added up come to 7.19 lakh crore. So for the 8 months, the collection has been on an average rupees 89,885 crores per month. So the government has explained that tax on domestic supplies in a month is collected through the returns process, and it's collected in a subsequent month because domestic supplies, there is an input tax credit coming too. So finally the returns get collected in the next month, and integrated GST cess on imports specifically get collected in the same month. So this has been stated, and this shows the collection of GST from July to March 2017. So for central and state GST, it is from August. So this is because from August onwards, means month of July, it was collected in August. So we have 8 months GST collected for central and state, and for integrated GST and cess on imports, it has been collected for 9 months now. So these are the news items. Thank you.